Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
I feel now like I have to overcome your massive disappointment over the SpongeBob movie.
Not really. Not anymore, back, I guess.
The back corner office guy's weeping.
Now that wouldn't surprise me.
Oh, I love SpongeBob. All right. Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. You go online, too, at sunburymotors.com. Check out the great lines they have. Ford, Lincoln, Kia, Hyundai, pre-owned inventory. You can get the buying process started all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. All right, our play-by-play call of the day. It's a beauty. It's Talladega yesterday.
The NASCAR Cup Series, lone black driver. After what happened here yesterday afternoon, the drivers, led by reigning Cup Series champion Kyle Busch in green, and their crews, the entire garage area, has rallied around Bubba Wallace and the number 43 today. Here comes Almirola. Crash into the wall. I think it's Stenhouse. It might be Blaney.
It was Blaney who won yesterday. Mike Joy with the call on Fox. An emotional beginning and exciting finish. You know, it's a warm day out today, Matt. It's up in the 80s here. Let's see, what is the actual temperature here? Let's check this out. We have 81 degrees here. 81 degrees. Probably about the same where you are, right?
I would say so.
Meanwhile, safely ensconced in the western part of the state, and I might admit to the audience, poolside is Neal Coolong. Neal, welcome.
It's a gorgeous day, gentlemen. I'm enjoying this. I'm enjoying it.
I bet you are.
The paleness of my skin can attest to how seldomly I get out.
Listen,
so I'm gonna probably burn myself to a crisp here as I'm on kid duty.
I
gotta watch the neighborhood kids here.
I can hear them in the background.
Yeah, I told them to be quiet, and they're not going to do that.
No, so. I don't want them quiet.
Yeah, you really can't do that.
No, excuse me. Five children, six grandchildren. Guess what? You do tell them to run around, yell and scream at them all they want, okay? Because it doesn't bother this guy, not in the least.
I got a good place for you then.
I didn't say I was coming over to help.
yeah, you and everybody else.
I want to say that the Paternos may have as many as 17 grandchildren, something like that. Big number. I remember years ago somebody was asking Joe about the grandkids. He mentioned all the grandchildren were there for something, and he says, yeah, you got to remember, I always have an office in the house. Yeah, an office in the house, like most of us do now. We all in office.
The escape
in the
path.
Yeah, the escape path, indeed. All right, so here we are sitting on June the 23rd, about a month from now, maybe what 5 weeks from now, there'd be a universal opening of camps, but there'll be four teams that'll be open now because they're playing the earlier games. All right, do they start on time?
Unfortunately, not to sound like a lawyer, but I think what this will eventually come down to is what you want to define as starting. I think they're going to start something. I think they'll end something else. I think they'll have different variations of things in between. This is going to be the least conventional setup that we've seen.
It's going to be
anything.
The least conventional everything we've ever seen.
Yeah, I mean,
that's 2020, the least conventional year of all.
They will have created something that on this day we can't really envision happening. That's my honest to God guess. I really think it's just going to be, there's so much stuff going on, and we're not going to know anything of it. In many ways, nothing has really changed since March. I mean, it's things got shut down, they opened back up, and amazingly, sitting in our house didn't get rid of any of this. It's going to be out there still, and we don't have any way to get past it. So we're going to have to find different, I don't know if solutions is the right word, but they're going to need to find different ways to get ready for the season if they want to start this in late July. And there's a lot of politics that are going to, you know, have to be kind of argued out and determined between now and then. So I think they're going to start something, because I think the NFL is bullheaded enough to say, we're going to be the one sport here that didn't have a stoppage in any way. We're going to be the ones that want to continue the way that we have been doing it. They won't want to stop that. They won't want to let go of that. So I think whatever it looks like, maybe it's fan-friendly, maybe it isn't, but they'll be organized, but I don't think it's going to be anything that looks like the training camp situation that we've seen in the past.
Today, they had a virtual meeting with the media, and Mike Tomlin did acknowledge that two Steelers players did test positive for COVID back in the spring. Now, that's in the spring. Said neither player was in the facility and that both players are currently in good health and preparing for the upcoming season. I mean, Neal, it's going to happen, and in all likelihood, it's going to happen, and it's probably going to be in the asymptomatic, because there's more. Everybody's going to be tested repeatedly.
Yeah, I mean, there's really no other way around it. For me, if anything, right now is a reason for the league to sit down and wonder, do they need to come up with some type of new mandate for roster expansion? Our team's going to be able to hold on to the full 90 guys that they have all year. You look at what's happening in college. I mean, LSU, Clemson, other schools have 20-some players who have eventually tested positive and had to be put into quarantine. Whatever those exact numbers are, I'm not sure, but that's a large percentage of your team. An NFL roster could not handle that. In training camp, they can hold 90, but if one guy comes down with it, which, come on, let's be honest, statistically that's going to happen, that could infect a bunch of other guys, and they're all together all the time.
Right, 5.3% is the testing number.
Yeah, so you look at that right there, that's a large chunk of your training camp roster. I think John Harbaugh said this fairly recently. He spoke to the media. What exactly are they supposed to do? There's no way they can, quote, socially distance in a locker room.
No.
You're going to have waves of people that go in and out and shower. I mean, there's no way that they can do it in the manner that would be best, most ideal, most efficient for them to do it, to get the work in that they need to. And I think the players are aware of that, and they're going to push back and say, look, this isn't even training camp. We don't even know what this is. This is going to be something that falls under our negotiating rights in the CBA.
Right.
We're going to have to sit down and talk about what this is exactly. And I think, you know, when Cam Hayward spoke recently, I think he kind of hinted at it. And I don't, maybe you guys can help me with this. I didn't even look it up. I was going to, but I would have thought Hayward would replace Ramon Foster as the team's union rep. I'm not sure when they elect that or when that comes to be, but he certainly would be in the mix.
Yeah.
You know, if he's not speaking on behalf of the union, he's definitely speaking on behalf of the team. He's captain and has been for years. He was very pointed in his comments. It didn't sound to me like he was real optimistic if things were going to continue forward with what we're seeing right now. And I think the NFL was waiting to see what would happen when more things reopen, and hopefully for them, when more sports reopen. If you get the NBA, if you get the NHL, seeing kind of how they're handling and what the results are, I think will go a ways with the NFL in figuring out how they're going to handle it long term.
Well, they're going to take the right tackle and make him the left guard with Ramon Foster. And then they're going to have Zach Banner and Okafor compete for the old right tackle spot. What do you think about those moves?
I think they signed Banner to a one-year deal, and they probably tried to get a team-friendly deal out of him. They probably tried to get something like 3 years, $6 million, while his stock was low, knowing that he's the guy that they're going to want to be their right tackle in the future. I think he knows that as well. He's made hints about it in the media, kind of saying that he's betting on himself. He took a very small one-year deal because the team could offer him a one-year deal, and I think that was the leverage that they had over him. They know what he's capable of doing. They've developed a lot of really good offensive linemen. I think he's the next one for them. I think he's going to be their starting right tackle. He's just trying to drive his price up for when he would hit free agency next year. And I think it'll work. I mean, what we've seen of him to this point, he's athletic. He's advanced well throughout the team. I mean, he used to be a nobody. He got himself into, you know, a prime backup spot last year. And that tends, for the Steelers, that tends to be a future starter. So I think he's aware of that. And he's ready to you know, kind of take over that spot of the line. It really is kind of a passing of the torch. I mean, if you look back, a lot of the old faces we've seen in the Steelers' offensive line, it feels like it was just yesterday. You had a completely new crop of guys. They've since come through, played really well, retired, or went on to considerably more greener pastures. And I think Banner is next in line to pick up on that. Filer as well. I think Filer is a guy that they want at a guard spot. They've worked him at guard until they had a need for him at tackle. And I thought he availed himself pretty well last year. Yeah. He's a solid player as well. So they're able to get both of them in on fairly cheap contracts.
Yeah.
And it's going to be real interesting. I thought they would emphasize the offensive line a little bit more than they did in this draft. They don't have a tackle except for Chuck's Corifor signed beyond this season. So I don't know what they're going to do. They have options. It's not a panic situation for them, but I think they hoped on letting this training camp kind of be their blueprint for the future, and they might not get it. So they might have to go on, you know, a little bit of unknown information, lesser known information than they might have been comfortable with before making a decision on a roster spot. But that's every team in the NFL now, and I think that's going to be kind of the story of the NFL moving into this decade.
Plus, they still have Stefan Wisniewski, who can give them some versatility there, too.
Yeah, he's a good depth signing for that very reason. You know, it gives them that veteran backup that they've always had in that spot.
Who could play guard or center? Javon Hargrave, all right, gone Eagles. So who gets the first shot there?
You know, I think Chris Wormley, the guy that they acquired via trade with Baltimore, I say that because it's not typical that the Steelers and Ravens would make trades with each other, but they also play defense similarly. And I know that the Steelers really valued Wormley as a mid-round pick when he was coming out a couple years ago. So I think he's a guy that they're going to want to emphasize early on. The question is, how much is that position going to be utilized? I think you get Hargrave on the field because he's Hargrave. I mean, you could see going into last season, this guy's a high-level player.
Yep.
We don't know if that's Wormley yet. I wouldn't necessarily say that, you know, he's going to fill in that role very nicely, but I also think that the role was kind of customized to be, Hargrave for that position. With Wormley in Baltimore, I think he played fairly well in a low number of snaps. They had probably a little bit deeper of a defensive line. He's somebody who could probably get the job done, and he's the veteran that didn't cost him a whole lot. Fifth-round draft pick doesn't seem to be something the team really prizes anymore. So they acquired what they think call it a starter because he might take the first snap of the game, but I don't think he's going to play more than 12 to 15 snaps a game either. So it depends on what they want to do, but I would say that they brought him in to at the very least be a stopgap and see what happens to him long term. He's athletic. He's going to need to put on some weight, but I think he can play along the high-end athleticism that they have along that line.
The Raiders' new stadium in Las Vegas cleared a major hurdle this week. There are 297 restrooms, 1,430 toilets, and they turned on the water at all the sinks, and the flush test worked. That stadium is now exponentially ahead of the Oakland Coliseum. Just on
probably why they ran that test right away. It's a PR move.
Oh,
that stadium. Oh my God, that was really something else. I mean, I've covered a game at Oco, and I've covered a game at the old Fawcett Stadium. I forget what they renamed it now, Benson Stadium in Canton, which is really a kind of a lower end high school stadium.
Yes,
Canton probably step for step was the same as Oco. It was just smaller, you know.
Yeah.
It's that stadium was that was an absolute disaster. I mean, regardless of where you stand with using city funding for a stadium, that place was a mess.
I mean,
nobody wanted to go there.
The Oakland A's had sewage backups.
That was a consistent problem.
It's not good when your minor league teams have better septic systems.
Yeah, the septic system, because that's, you know, something the fans should be talking about. You know, anytime that those two words come up, it's a negative conversation. You know, oh, they have the best septic system in the league. We always said that. That place was an absolute hole. I mean, they're much better off in any other city than playing there. I understand why they ended up moving. It's frustrating to see. I like the history of Oakland.
Yeah.
You know, I like the Oakland Raiders. I didn't like the Los Angeles Raiders a whole lot. It sounds better in Oakland. We'll see with Vegas. You know, nothing else. They could give them a shiny new stadium. It looks cool. It looks real. You know, from an architectural standpoint, it looks awesome from the outside.
Yeah.
And I think it'll be a draw. You know, we'll see if they can figure out a way to put a winner on the field. You know, they're moving in some sort of direction. I'm not sure if it's the best they could be just yet, but. They kind of counted on a certain wide receiver to be working in year two right now, and that didn't work out so well. So they had a good draft. They had a good draft. You know, the guys that they brought in, I think, are going to be players.
I mean, from
they can figure out the quarterback position.
Right. Yeah, I mean, from the air, it looks like one of those vacuum cleaner robots.
It totally does.
But I will say this, right? You don't have to close down the stadium. Because, like they did in October of 2016, when it was flooded with undesirable.
It's funny. I was just doing a podcast with a 49ers show today or tomorrow. I forget. The point is we're going to discuss the 2011 Steelers game at Candlestick when the lights went out.
Oh, yeah. I remember that night.
The storylines that went into that game are actually pretty remarkable. That was an up-and-coming 49ers team. It was like the first time they'd been on primetime in however long.
Yep.
And the lights go out right after halftime. This is in the process of them building their new stadium in Santa Clara and everything. But Ben's hurt in that game. He plays poorly. He turns the ball over four times. Steelers defense, which had been good all year, statistically probably a lot better than what you had ever looked at them being that season. And maybe it was because, you know, the previous year they were a turnover machine and went to the Super Bowl. But it really kind of a changing of the guard game. But the main thing I always take away from that is the hour-long delay because the lights in the entire stadium just went out. You really don't see that much.
Well, with the 49ers, you do. Because of the Super Bowl, where we still think Jim Harbaugh turned out the lights.
I still can't believe that. Four throws. I mean, you've got Colin Kaepernick. Say what you will about the guy physically.
Run
you know
the
that
ball.
He can move.
Run.
Ray Lewis's tongue was on the ground.
I couldn't believe he didn't run him one time.
I would have at least tried the run, but if nothing else, get Kaepernick out on the edge.
Yes.
Get his legs moving. Make them commit somewhere. Give him a run-pass option. Let the 6'5", 230-pound athlete get to the pylon if you have to. If you don't want to hand it off and run behind probably the best run-blocking offensive line in the league.
And then you run
the ball. Instead, what are you doing? You're throwing fades to Michael Crabtree.
I mean,
how does that look now in retrospect?
Oh,
what a mess. What a mess. That was frustrating. And, of course, he's screaming for holding calls after. Like, yeah, they're going to call that in the Super Bowl with 10 seconds left in the game.
Can't win the Super Bowl. Can't beat Ohio State. Can't win in Beaver Stadium. Okay. It's just a long list.
Lots of problems there. Lots of great stuff between the 20s, but you get inside the red zone, he's not putting it home. That's his career.
Well, it sounds like the party toned down.
Yeah, they moved over to a different corner now. I'm not sure what is going on, but...
You better find out.
Yeah, this might be trouble for me. They might be breaking into the stuff that's behind the container that they have over there. There's all the pool toys and everything like that. I think they're digging in to get it all out, but that's all stuff that I have to clean up. I wish I could send you a picture, because you know those big, long, like 10-foot pool skimmers?
Yeah.
that, you know, you clean up the lid, that's currently sitting at the bottom of the shallow end right now. That's a new development. That's happened since we were on the boat. The thing that we use to get things out of the pool.
Is so in
one
the
of
pool.
Them dropped their mask. It's there 5 feet down to the bottom. Yeah, they used the pool skimmer to get it. They dropped the pool skimmer. So the pool skimmer is sitting next to the mask right now. That's great. Now we're going to figure that out.
Glad to be of some sort of assistance today.
I'll hit you up offline here and let you know how it goes.
Thanks. I appreciate that, Neal.
Smack dab in the middle, man. I don't even know how they got it there. But
that's what makes them kids, man. That's what makes them kids. Yeah. They do things you sit back and go, I don't know how you did that.
Indeed. Humbling.
We'll talk next week, my friend. Thanks.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Good luck. This is something for you, Matt Cotrillo, to look forward to.
I was just thinking that.
I could see that little ringleader, Luke Joseph, leading the other kids, and the pool skimmer is at the bottom, and you're asking yourself, how did he get there? Little Luke's face mask is sitting at the bottom. How'd it get there? This will be your story. Part of our story is taking a break here on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by Sunbury Motors.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Great to have you with us, brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Key Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Check out the great lines of Ford, Lincoln, Kia, Hyundai, and great pre-owned inventory, all at sunburymotors.com. You can get the buying process from the comfort of your own home. Very pleased to have with us Bob Pockrass, Fox NASCAR reporter. Bob, welcome. I hope you and yours are safe and sound and doing well.
Thank you very much. Hope everyone there is well, too.
I appreciate that. All right, so let's talk about what happened with Bubba Wallace. Yesterday, weekend. First of all, there are cameras in the garages, correct?
It's a great question. There normally are. And I think the question is, this Talladega garage area was just built in last summer. And so there's a huge fan area, and fans can actually virtually go, and I mean, they can look in the garage. They can, they're just separated by a fence. So we think that there should be some security cameras there, but with no fans, they may not have been active. And then the other issue is that NASCAR typically brings a lot of cameras with them, sets them up for areas that where they do inspections and other areas in the garage, just to monitor, to make sure there's nothing crazy going on in the garage. But because of their COVID-19 protocols, they've had fewer people at the track, and it's my understanding that a lot of those cameras haven't been used over the last 5 or 6 weeks. You would think if they had camera footage of the noose in Bubba Wallace's garage that they would have possibly have taken action already against the person who did it.
I was going to say, I mean, if there were cameras like there, you would think there would be an open and shut case. I know Willie T. Ribbs was interviewed last night. He said he's not surprised by any of this. Are you surprised by it?
You know, it's a great question. I was 22 years old, standing on the grid in Indianapolis when Willie T. Ribbs became the first black driver to make it into the Indy 500. And you think, man, you know, this is progress. And now 29 years later, you see this and you say, well, how much progress have we made as a society? I'm surprised, just mainly because this is an area that that's so controlled at the moment because of COVID-19. NASCAR screens everybody who goes in. They have them fill out forms. They're showing be 800 or 900 people there. You're talking the crews, NASCAR officials, EMS, some vendors who do parts and pieces for the teams, and some track security and some track cleaning people. So in that sense, I'm surprised. But look, you know that we still have a ways to go in society.
Which, of course, there was the Confederate flag flown over Talladega. First of all, what did you think about NASCAR's ruling on the Confederate flag? And in your opinion, what is the reception to it?
Well, I think when all the drivers create a video a couple weeks ago about how they're going to advocate for a change and take a stand against racism and racial inequality, and NASCAR president, you know, says the same. He says the sport has to change. The country has to change. But when the next day, when Bubba Wallace comes out and says, well, NASCAR needs to ban the Confederate flag, I don't know that NASCAR had much choice, right? Because if they don't do something, then their words just are totally hollow. And so they knew that they were going to have to take action. This was probably one of the actions they planned on taking. Maybe it came sooner than what they had planned, but I think it was something that they knew they had to do, and they knew that there was going to be people who were upset. You know, I believe a group called the Sons of Confederate Veterans has taken a responsibility for flying the flag. Over the track in the few hours before the race was scheduled to be run. There were some, maybe a couple dozen protesters standing outside track grounds over the weekend. But, NASCAR knew that was going to happen. They know they are going to, there's going to be a time where they're going to have to ask somebody to remove the flag, and they'll be tested on whether, what do they do if this person refuses? Do they make them take down the flag? Do they just evict them immediately? You know, they have all those things they need to decide. And then you're talking about also people wearing shirts and hats and belt buckles and those kinds of things, and how will NASCAR react? I think it's still in some ways to be determined.
So let's talk about how NASCAR reacted yesterday. How powerful a moment, in your opinion, was the support behind Bubba Wallace before the race began?
Well, it was the ultimate, we've got your back moment, right? It was the ultimate, we support you. And, one of the drivers said today that, Bubba said to them all, I know half of you love me and half of you hate me, but I'm appreciative of y'all supporting me, right. Typically, as like any race car driver, you have your friends and you have the people who you've gotten into run-ins on the racetrack, and they have differences of opinion. But I think it showed that the drivers have a power when they are united, and that they can speak as a group. You know, there's just so few of them. There's 40 of them, and typically they don't agree on a lot, but when someone does something in your home, which is their garage area, it's not just something that's against obviously it's focused on Bubba, but it's a signal to all of them, and I think that I think they reacted in a way that that they wanted to show their support, and they wanted to show that for lack of a better term, the idiots are not going to win.
Bob, I believe what they let some fans into Homestead, correct? Military?
Yeah, they let some fans into Homestead, a few thousand into Talladega, but then no fans, obviously, for Pocono in the next few weeks until they'll have some fans at Texas.
Okay. Has there been any indication about their comfort level with doing this? Are they getting more comfortable with the possibility, or are they still about the same as they were a month ago?
I think NASCAR is comfortable with having fans. They want to have fans. I think it's a matter of the states that they are in and what's permissible and what's not. And I don't think, I get the feeling that if whatever the states will allow them to do, they'll do. You know, in Texas, they haven't even set a certain amount of fans that they can have in there because they want to be able to seat families together. So, you know, so they won't really know how many seats they have available until they know, like, well, are we talking about groups of two, or, you know, will we have some groups of eight? And obviously, if you can have eight people together and then the next group 6 feet apart, you can have more people than if it's just, you know, two people together, 6 feet apart, another two people, 6 feet apart, another two people.
What has impressed you about the restart to this season?
I would say that what's impressed me is that the racing has probably been a little bit better than I expected. You know, I thought that the big teams would just run away with these races because of the resources they have. But you've been able to see the Richard Childress Racing teams, and they have an alliance with Richard Petty Motorsports and Bubba Wallace. And you know, you've seen the two RCR cars and Bubba's car have run pretty well over the last month. So I think to me that's the kind of the most impressive thing, is that it hasn't just been, you know, a case where, well, you know, the big teams always have the advantage. You know, at Martinsville, you saw most of the Gibbs cars, except for Truex, who won, you know, had awful days. So I think that there's something to be said, you know, when you don't have practice, that, you know, there are going to be teams that are going to hit on the setup, and then their teams are going to miss. And while most likely it'll be the big teams that do come through in the end, there's still a little bit more of a little bit more of a roll the dice factor.
Are there any differences? Like, is any team a little bit better now than before the stoppage, where, you know, they're kind of going along okay at the stoppage, but now they're racing a lot better? Who might that be right now? And then at the other end, who's actually fallen back a bit from the early part of the season to the stoppage?
Yeah, I think that the latter is easier to talk about, because you look at a guy like Kyle Busch. He's a guy who just thrives on having practice and being able to make those small changes to make his car great for Sundays, and he just hasn't had that. I think on the other end, you know, you look at a rookie like Tyler Reddick, he doesn't really know what he's supposed to feel. He just goes out and races. And so I think, you know, that he's like, okay, he's not looking for anything specific. So he kind of thrives in this environment, and it'll be interesting to see in Pocono this weekend. I would expect Kyle Busch to be much better on Sunday than he is on Saturday, because he's going to have about 325 miles, quote unquote, practice on Saturday for Sunday. While Tyler Reddick, he might not be able to point his team into what improvements they need to make for Sunday.
But you know what? Sometimes, look, I think experience makes such a big difference, but there is something to be said for, yeah, okay, let's just go. let's just go. I have no problem with that. When you look at the state of the sport right now, how important is not just this year, because they got back first, but how important is next year to set the sport up for the future, because they've wanted to make so many good faith changes?
Yeah, well, I think it all depends on what type of schedule changes they can make, because, you know, originally they were hoping to debut this new next-gen car in 2021, but they've had to push that debut back to now 2022. But, you know, they do hope to have, you know, a different schedule, hope to have a few different racetracks. They've already announced that they're going to go to Nashville Super Speedway for a race, take a race from Dover and move it there. So I think it really depends on what new markets they can go to and what type of what type of racing they can put on in those facilities, you know, especially like if they do a street course or a different road course or a new short track, who might thrive in those situations.
I have to ask one last question. Now, growing up, when I'd watch racing, you would get in the car, and the first one to get to 500 miles, 400, or in Charlotte, 600, wins. I'm not quite on board with the stage deal. How do you feel about that?
I like the stage deal because I feel like it creates an urgency in the race.
Okay.
I feel like that it you're like, okay, these guys have something to race for in the first 50 or 60 laps. And I like time to go get snacks, so I like stages for all those things, and it can be frustrating, but you know the other point of stages is it creates a break. They take at most races, you know, you'll have a couple of laps of caution, which I know frustrates people, but it's time for commercials, and it's a way for us on Fox and FS1 when we're showing races to potentially show more green flag racing, and so I think that's a plus. Again, I know if you've been watching racing all your life, you're like, why are we just stopping the race? It just doesn't make sense, but. I liked it, I think it's created an urgency during a race that I think creates some interest, and certainly it works at some tracks and not as much as others.
Well, let me put it this way: I also feel you talk about green flag racing. I felt like so far in the restart, there's been more green flag racing than I've seen in a long time. The racing's been pretty good. Hey, Bob, yep. Thanks so much. I really appreciate the time you gave us today and the insight you gave us as well. Really appreciate it.
All right, thank you, and looking forward to seeing some racing at Pocono.
Yeah, absolutely, on the old Trioval. Looking forward to it. Bob Pockrass joining us from Fox NASCAR. We will come back with more in a moment and wrap up this broadcast extravaganza as only we can on News Radio 1070. WKOK. When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years. All right, well, unfortunately, as much fun as I had talking with Bob, and I thought Bob was great, evidently somebody in the back corner office timed out the interview, and now we have to have an equal time IndyCar interview that goes 13 minutes and 42 seconds.
Is that right?
I don't get it. I mean, this isn't a political campaign. it's not like we had a Democrat on. We have to give a Republican equal time. I mean, that's... But evidently, he wants more IndyCar coverage, and if we have NASCAR on, we have to have IndyCar on for the exact same time.
We still got a couple weeks yet, even. Actually, no, I'm sorry. Next week.
It is next week, yes. Yeah. Is it the Saturday, the 4th?
I believe so. I'm not 100% positive. I'd have to ask him.
I think it's the 4th, and I think it's an Indy.
It is, yeah. It's the road course portion of Indy, and that's apparently an Indy NASCAR doubleheader. Because NASCAR is going to be there on Sunday for the Brickyard 400, and the Indy car is Saturday. So, yeah, Indy car is Saturday. I just answered my own question. I forgot that NASCAR is going to be there after Pocono.
Just when I was running out of reasons to live, you give me that. All right, so... really, a NASCAR IndyCar doubleheader. Okay. There you go. That's what we needed. Well, now we have to have an IndyCar interview the exact same length. Do me a favor. Forget we had this conversation.
What conversation?
That's exactly right. That's my man right there. Oh, I can't believe it. Good suit light to work on it.
Although I really enjoyed that race yesterday. I think that was the best of the year. I think any NASCAR fan would agree with me.
See, I thought it was on in the evening. And, of course, you know, when it came time to start watching anything here, we had a torrential downpour. And we had a lightning strike that was very close to the house yesterday. Right after the show, we turned a lot of things off. There we go. But yeah, that's that was good. Neal was on and. Great to have him on today. Andrew Brandt today. Bob Pockrass today. No IndyCar today. I'm not helping myself, am I?
Probably not, but that's okay.
Well, great to have you with us today, as always. Brought to you by Sunbury Motors.